Wow, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so, so much. Ladies and gentlemen, we've heard it. Check that your cover is still adequate, just some of the things that I've picked up. When he said, do you want flowers or do you want a check? I just burst out laughing. My husband knows, he's sat there somewhere. Flowers, it's just not me. So I want a check. But I mean, he put it succinctly when he said, you want them to bring you flowers, but more importantly, also a fat check. So that hit me. The four sources of income. So are you just doing your 9-to-5 and not doing anything else? You know, we need to rethink some of these things. Another one that hit home, he said, financially, well, he didn't quite put it that way, but this is the way I've put it. He said, financially okay is a myth. You're either rich or you're poor. I was like, ouch. Everybody say, ouch. So are you rich or are you poor? Just like him, don't give me the answer, but just know it. Let your dream exceed your capacity. Let your dream exceed your capacity. Do all you have to do so that you can then sleep as much as you like. Join a queue, stay in the queue. Don't jump from Mary Kay to Mary Luca, I think you said. I laughed. Read and become an expert in your field. Thank you so much, sir. It was an absolute blessing listening to you. We're going to move very, very quickly. We've been handing out some slips. They're for questions, which the speakers will address. So please start to put your questions down. And please do remember that we're a very social bunch. And so if you tweet, if you're on Instagram, please remember, keep taking pictures all through the day. Hashtag Open Eyes Ministry, hashtag TC, hashtag From Debt to Prosperity. It'll be nice to reference the date and the venue. Thank you so much. And please remember to start putting your questions down. Now to our third speaker. It gives me great pleasure to read this bio, and you'll know very soon why, or you might know already. Pastor Yemi Odusolu. Whoop, whoop. So our other speakers, we're not being partial or anything, it's just we're at home. PYO, as he's fondly called, is a former banker, systems consultant, investment analyst, and trainer. He enjoyed an extensive career in the financial services sector, both in the United Kingdom and Nigeria. An avid reader with a deep quest for knowledge, he holds a BSE and an MBA. PYO has consulted for a number of Fortune 500 companies, trained and mentored scores of people, and is very passionate about teaching people to fulfill their destinies and make an impact. PYO is also a board member and chair of the Well Board Committee of Tear Fund, an international Christian charity with a passion for seeing people released from material and spiritual poverty. He is passionate about teaching the gospel and seeks to empower people, shaping and impacting society. PYO loves reading, traveling, watching movies, and spending time with the family. PYO is married to Adejumoke, who we fondly refer to as PJO, this says, but we fondly refer to her as PJ. So it is my absolute honor to welcome you to the podium. We see you here every Sunday, but nonetheless, we're happy to have you here again. PYO.
Praise the name of the Lord. Please be seated. Please be seated. Wow, wow, wow. What a tough act to follow after Morenike and Festus. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you to you both. It's interesting. When I reflected on the topics that they were told to share and the topic that I was given to share, I thought, okay, there's an interesting alignment that needs to happen here. And as they spoke, there was a buzz in my spirit, and you would see that very shortly. I've been asked to speak on the Christian overview of finance, but you'd probably imagine that as a former banker, I'm speaking more about the finance than the Christian. But there's an overlap, and thank you so much for coming, Reverend, and Pastor Masson. We go way, way, way back in time. Childhood friend in every sense of the word. Time won't permit me to get into some of the stuff that we got into. But thank God for Christ. He's definitely one of my very, very, very bosom friends. And we thank God for nearly 40 years of relationship. And we're still going. And still strong. And I only remember one quarrel in all that time. In 40 years. Mild. But that's the strength of friendship. And thank you so much for both your sessions. There are things they've spoken to that I will just gloss over. But scripture tells us in 2 Corinthians 13, I believe it is, that out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, the truth is established. So where you find an overlap between the things that they've spoken to and the things that I'm going to be speaking to, make a note of those things, because God is definitely speaking to us. I am going to emphasize debt, but I'm also going to speak about money, and I'm also going to speak about finance, and I believe God to illuminate it on our hearts. Can we have the slides up? Are we good with the slides? Are we ready? Excellent. So I said debt, understanding it, managing it, and a play on characters. There's a piggy bank there that speaks to putting the pennies away. There's a saying that if you take care of the pennies, the pounds will take care of themselves. And this is going to be very practical, very, very practical. I've had the good fortune of teaching financial education for the last 20 years. And many, many, many testimonies have come from it. Since I've been asked to speak as a Christian, and since I am a pastor, it is important that everything that I'm going to share with you is founded and structured on scripture. And so if you go with me into scripture, Proverbs the 22nd chapter and the 7th verse says, just as the rich rule the poor, so the borrower is servant to the lender. So borrowing makes us a servant. And we're not supposed to be in servitude. And so we may be on a journey towards mastery, but we must not stay in the place of servitude. 2 Kings 4:7. The widow came to the prophet and acknowledged and established that the prophet knew that the husband was a servant of a prophet. So he was a man of God. He was a minister. But alas, he had died. And alas, he had left debt. And alas, there was no protection. So I love that image, flowers or check. I loved it. So in 2 Kings 4, the prophet had to make a miracle. You know, when we have not done the right things at the right time, then we need to cause a suspension of a natural for the supernatural to come through and help us. And God will always come through. Thank God for God. But how much better it would be to gain the knowledge, to gain the principles, to gain the ideas, to do the right things, so that the things that we're leaving to God to do are not the things that God expected us to take care of. But in this situation, the man of God called upon God. God showed mercy. Please, don't leave everything to the calling to God for mercy. It can sometimes be a painful, difficult journey. Said, go sell the oil and pay your debts. You and your sons live on the difference. There's several things encaptured here. One, debt is never forgiven. Festus told us, and Morenike mentioned it as well. You will pay your debt. Some people think, oh, pile up on the credit cards and when you die, it will be canceled. Fa, 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 fa. There's nothing like that. They come against your estate. They come against everything they can touch. So we must pay our debts. We must sell. It says, go sell the oil. So there was an oil. There was multiplication of the oil. But the widow still had to do something. She had to learn merchandise. If she didn't learn merchandise, the oil would sit at home in the many bowls that she had borrowed. or many buckets that she had borrowed. And in selling the oil, she and her sons could now live on what is left. And the third one is Ecclesiastes 7:12 says, for wisdom is a defense, as money is a defense. The excellency of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to those who have it. Trust me, my friends, we need money. Say money, money, money. Money. We need money. Everything that we do in life, there's a currency that is constantly flowing, and it is the currency of money. I know there's something about debt and borrowing, and I'm going to be speaking a bit about that. And again, one of the previous speakers shared on Proverbs 21:20. Says the wise person, I think it was Marenke shared on that, saves for the future, but the foolish man spends all that he gets. I loved it when Festus said to us, who is financially secure? And I'm sure many of us didn't raise our hands because we weren't quite sure what financial security looked like. But now we do. You are richer than you think you are. You have more than you think you do. Debt is not a problem. Death, when we use the word debt, I mean D-E-B-T, not D-E-A-T-H. So debt is not in itself the problem. The real problem is the application of debt. Some people go, I don't use credit cards. I don't want to get into debt. Yeah, in principle, okay. But you live in a society that does one thing before they speak to you, they do your credit check. I remember saying to my wife when we came to this country 25 years ago, I said, get a credit card, use it, but pay down every month without fail. Why? You are establishing a track record. You are showing the system that you have integrity and you're reliable. So you're not helping yourself. You say, okay, I cash, God bless mama, I take all the cash into a black bag. It's lost to the system. All the system knows is that this person just takes all their money out and they don't do it. Only God knows what they do with it. Are they gambling with the money? Are they financially prudent? So it is important that you have a footprint in the system. I thank God that we had a footprint and still have a footprint in the system. If I have time, I'll share more about that as we go along. Borrowing, though, obligates you to earning pressure. If you borrow and borrow and borrow. So as good as it is to build a credit record, it imposes on everyone a discipline, a rigor to ensure that that's the first thing you sort out. Amen? That's the first thing you do what? You sort out. You must pay your debt. Otherwise, it compels you. It constrains your lifestyle. It forces you to live by the dictates of the creditor and not necessarily by your dictates. They can even tell you you can't pay tithes in insolvency arrangements. So why are you paying this 10% to a church? Why? Because you owe them. You live according to their choice and their dictates. It takes away joy. You know, it takes away the liberty, Marenke shared it, to buy, to give, to spend, to enjoy. You have such a freedom once they've put the money in your hands, which is your earning or your income, to do what you will with it, provided you are the master of your own destiny. If you transfer that privilege to a lender, they will determine what you do with your money. It erodes giving opportunities. We are Christians. Our greatest joy as believers is to be a flow. A flow. We receive, we give. We receive, we give. We receive, we give. When that is taken away, the joy of a believer is constrained. Your compassion has no effect if you are not able to also be a blessing. And it unmasks character flaws. Many times, debt is a symptom of a deeper problem. A lack of contentment, a lack of patience, a lack of trust, and a lack of self-discipline. I have breaking news for you. Interest rates are on the rise. The Bank of England raised rates again this week to 4.5%. I don't care how wealthy you are. You started to take notice. When it went from 0.5 to 1, it didn't matter. It got to 1.5, we still could shake it off. It got to 2, you started to be like, these people are taking this joke too far. It got to 2.5. And have you noticed that every time they raise the rate, you get a text message followed by a letter? Mortgages are now in the 5 to 7.5% range. It is starting to pinch. Credit cards are 25% per annum. That's 3 times mortgage rates. They're not necessary, they're information. They should not determine how we live our lives, but we better have knowledge. My people perish for lack of knowledge. You know, there's something called zero interest rate offers. I think they're a fantastic financial tool, but they bait. They're baiting you to come in and take their zero interest credit card in the assumption and the hope that you will be indisciplined, that the period they give you, you will not live your life constrained within it, and you will tap into 24% interest rate. And I'm going to show you some tables that are going to blow your mind this morning. So take the 0% interest rate by all means, but send yourself a reminder on your phone. Send yourself a reminder on your whatever tool it is. Tell your neighbor to remind you. Tell me, your pastor, to remind you. Call the church office and tell them to remind you. Before those 12 months expire, whatever it takes, make sure that you regularize it. And let me tell you the beauty of the system we live in. Before that one expires, because your credit rating is good, another one has sent you another offer of zero. So just take it from 1-0 interest to put it in another 0 interest. In the event that the finances are unstructured, are difficult, it's a season. It will come to pass. But the power of compounding works in two ways. It works in savings, and it works in an accelerated fashion in debt. We're going to look at that this morning. J. Reuben Clark says, once you are in debt, interest becomes your companion. Please put that up on the screen. Interest becomes your companion every minute of the day and night, and it's working against you. It has no love, no sympathy. It is hard and soulless as a granite cliff, and you cannot dismiss it. Whenever you get in its way or cross its course or fail to meet its demand, it crushes you. Debt is dangerous. I think between Festus' quote and that, if you didn't have fear of debt, you better start having fear of debt. Debt is dangerous. And you know, the thing about life is that money becomes is a real issue of discussion. Even in homes, money, like the couple. Guys, flow with me very quickly. We don't have time. Okay, just flow with me. The couple are sitting down at the table, and what are they talking about? Money. But see, the thing about money is that we have money personalities. And the next slide, I'm going to break it down for you. There are people, and our money personality determines how we relate to money. There are people who are spenders/shoppers. There are people who are savers. There are people who are investors. And there are people who are debtors. And sometimes people can't even help themselves. So I have on here 7 money personalities. The complete saver, who will always seek to save money. They save money endlessly, almost to the point of, what's the word I'm looking for? It's not frugality. It's they save even to the detriment of themselves. You know, I'll couch it is, there's someone that we know who passed on, and the entire family was shocked at how much money they left behind. It's like, how can this person have this kind of money in the bank? How? How is it possible? Because they lived so beggarly. That is just as bad as a compulsive spender who is always just thinking about spending. In fact, when they go into challenges and emotional difficulties, the first thing they do is go and spend. You know, they just want to spend. And then it's compulsive money maker. He just wants to make money. Just make money, make money, make money. Pursue, pursue, pursue. It's a good thing to make money. But don't let it become your whole life. Don't let it take over your life. Live life. I'm happy the two speakers said it. Enjoy life. You're only going to live this way once. And as we're starting to see, there's no postponing anything. Because who knows how long anybody has. And there's the indifferent to money. They don't really pay too much heed to money. But they tend to be financially well off because they use money. Then the saver splurger, always switching between being a spender and a saver. There are people who will save well, but when they go to town, they go to town. You will know, you know. And they tend to do well with their spending. And the gambler, always a mix between the spender and the money maker, but they take big risks with money. When we were asked to break into groups and discuss what we would do with £100,000, different ideas came. Some said cryptocurrency, some said buy food and sell it on. Different ideas came from the different groups. Someone said get into childcare. That starts to give you a sense of people's disposition to money. What is our attitude to money? You just need to know where you are. Because knowing where you are will enable you to begin to reconfigure and redirect. And there's the warrior. The warrior simply constantly worries about money. They are worried about what they have. They're worried about what they don't have. They're worried about what they can get. Now, over the years, as I thought on financial education, the next slide has always been a paramount pivotal one. It's called the cycle of life. And that's a lot of what Festus was talking to you about. Early in life, we don't have a lot of money. Because we're still building up. It's the year one, year two, year three of that property progression that he showed us. And in those early years, while money may be short, we have one advantage. We have the advantage of youthfulness. We have the advantage of early life. And so it is important at that stage to start to lock down structures. So if you have protection in those early ages, it costs you the least it can, one. Two, it ensures that you start to build a foundation upon which money is going to come. I hope I'm making sense to you. Later in life, you don't have as much need for coverage. Children have left home. Think your structures are now solid. It's not in your late 50s or early 60s you want to buy life insurance. Even the insurer is not a fool. They know that the likelihood of payout is closer. But if you took out insurance in your late 30s, mid-20s, you get it for next to nothing. I've had insurance on my life for the last, on our lives actually, joint life, for the last 20-odd years. 20-odd years, 20, 22 years. And it's for a lot of money. I won't tell you how much so that I can be safe. That's a joke, by the way. But it was always my comfort, besides being a pastor and carrying the anointing, was that if anything were to happen to me, my family were not going to be destitute. It's the first thing that goes out every month, and it's still present continuous. But it's not for all of my life. It's still the age of 65. My son is here, so by 65, you better have taken care of yourself. Because after 65, if I go, you won't get anything. It's nada. But some would say, oh, pastor, but even my wife said to me at one point, you mean we've been paying this thing for 20 years and nothing is coming? I said, yes, he's been buying insurance. So that I'm still alive after 20 years, thank God. But if anything had happened, and over the next limited years left before the term insurance expires, if anything happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it's just an expense. So don't think about, oh, I'm parting with this money. Think about what it is buying for you. Now, let me show you this slide. A pound a day is what I titled it. Again, the two speakers spoke to it. And it has four columns in it. No, a pound a day. A pound a day, I think, is the previous slide after cycle of life. There we go. No, what's happening to a pound a day? It's not showing up. That's strange. No, go back one. It's one of the very important slides that I need to show. Well, see what's going on there. I don't know why. Maybe the image. But what that's, I need us to show that slide. Can you guys please work on that? But we'll carry on while you do that for time. What that slide shows us essentially is if you put a pound, if you engage with a pound every day, one, by putting it in your pillow, call it the piggy bank, okay? Or two, invest it at 10%. Or three, borrow it at 20%. And you keep doing that every single day over 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45 years. What will have happened? And that's why it's a very important slide to show. And I'll read it to you, but whenever they get it ready, we'll show it. Otherwise, we'll send the slides to you later. In 5 years, just putting a pound away every day for 5 years, after 5 years, you would have £1,820 saved. No interest involved. However, if you were to invest it at 10%, property generally gains 7% a year, even in spite of all the up and down, up and down, up and down. Mutual funds would typically pay you an average of about 10% a year. Those are still relatively safe investments. Buying index funds will give you about the same. So it is not impractical that you can earn 10%, okay? But it tends to be, some years will be 20, some years will be 5, some years will be 7. It evens out. So at 10%, over 5 years, the same £1,000 would have made you £2,320. Imagine if you borrowed it at 20%. You'll be owing £3,000. Now, it's more visual, it was pictorial, but media is working on it. Over 25 years of a pound a day. Over 25 years, you'll be owing £180,000. Whereas if you had invested it at 10%, now watch this, you would have accrued £37,000. If you put it in your piggy bank, it would have been about £9,000. Do you see how dangerous debt is? Debt goes easily 8 to 10 times or more what savings does. It has an amplifier effect. And do you know why? I think I have another slide that speaks to that. So if you borrow £100 and the credit card company would say just pay £5 a month, the minimum, for as long as all you're doing is paying the £5, you're accelerating the doubling of that debt. So there are people, you'd have heard tales of people who would say, but I only borrowed £2,000. How come I'm owing them 20? You borrowed £2,000 and for 5 years you didn't service it. You are owing good money. Okay? The next slide talks about debt management. £15,000 at 10%, you'll be paying interest of £125 a month. £15,000 at 25%, which is credit card rate, you'll be paying £312 a month. And £250,000 at 5%, you'll be paying £104 per month. So the first question you must always ask is, what is the applicable interest rate? We were going to buy a car for my wife once. Let's put up the next slide, compound interest rule of 72. We're going to buy a car for my wife, and we used to buy our cars cash for years. And then I came to the realization that that was not an efficient use of money. So debt is not a bad thing, but it's how you use debt. And so the next car we're going to buy, we said, okay, we're interested to do higher purchase. And the first question I asked them is, what is the APR? Annual percentage rate. The salesman tried to deflect. He tried to say, what is the APR? He knew that he'd been clobbered. When you start to hear certain APRs, run for your life. In layman's language, APR is interest rate. Always ask the question, what is the interest rate per annum? They will try and entice you with many different things. The industry we sit in is full of sharks. You must be knowledgeable to ask the right questions, but it's very basic. This slide, rule of 72, is one of the most powerful tools you must take away from here today. And what does Rule of 72 says? It says, take any rate of interest and divide it into 72, and it tells you how long the money will double. So if you put money in the bank and they're paying you 3% per annum, let's use 2% so my mathematics will not be challenged. They're paying you 2% per annum. It's going to take 36 years for that money to double. Hello. So add 36 to your current life and look at what double the money will be in 36 years' time. And let's not even get into the matter of inflation and the time value of money. Okay? So you must be pushing to increase your interest rate, but increase it without falling into the trap of taking excessive risk, which cryptocurrency is, where you can lose 10, 20% of the value of your investment in one day. But the flip side then works, which is what we're talking about today, debt. When you borrow on your credit card at 25%, that is real today and going up because it's benchmarked against Bank of England base rate. And that base rate that used to be 0.5% is now 4.5. And I think it's going to 5, and then we'll see what happens. So if you borrow at 24%, let's say you borrow £10,000, and all you do is pay the £5 minimum every month, they will collect it and say your account is regular. But in 3 years' time, you no longer owe £10,000, you owe £20,000. And in the middle of that time, you've bought first class ticket or business class ticket. You've taken trip to Hawaii. You've gone to Paris for weekend. You've bought, for the sake of those who are non-Yoruba speaking, you bought traditional attire. Your wardrobe is full of traditional attire that you only wear once because it's uniform. You've gone to party and exchanged £10 for $10, which is already a depreciation. And then you spray the $10. And yet you're owing the bank and you haven't serviced your loan. Now imagine for a second that instead of paying them £5 a month, you strain yourself and you pay £100 every month. You start to bring down the time value factor. And so before you know it, you've reduced your debt significantly. Does that make sense? And that applies to your mortgage as well. Even on your mortgage, you should pay more than the minimum. Now, what causes debt? Okay, I'm also having technical challenges here now. What causes debt? Many of it are lifestyle issues. Let's tell ourselves the truth. Many of us need to look at our lifestyles. You may already be in debt, but you don't have to stay in debt. But the worst thing than being in debt is increasing debt. Can you try and start to reduce it? Consumptive patterns. I mean, we had a real life story, and I'm so glad she was vulnerable enough to share it. Time won't allow me to share my story. I have several stories I could share with you. We could do this for a whole day, and maybe one day we will, where we take a whole day, but the people have to want it so that they will come, so that we're not speaking to an empty hall. Praise God. But there's so much knowledge I'm here, even from the previous speakers. Consumptive patterns. There's always something you can cut back on. There's always something you can change. I've always had BT internet in my house. But for a long time, I had BT and I had Sky. And for several, easily 2-3 years, I kept saying, I need to cut off Sky. And I didn't. And I was paying Sky £90 every month. And I had BT, because BT is my internet. So one day I got tired of it. And I called them and I said, cancel it. They threw me every carrot. I said, no. It turned out that I was just wasting £100 every month. Because everything that where is even the time to watch the TV anyway? So I didn't pay BT any more money than I was paying them before. And so every channel that I had on Sky, BT gave me for the same money that I always spent, effectively the same £100. And so I was spending £1,200 a year that I didn't have to spend, and I did it for close to almost 5 years. That's about £5,000-6,000. There is money in your house. Go and look closely. There's jewelry you have that you haven't worn for God knows how long. In fact, you say it's gone out of fashion. Your own rag is somebody else's treasure. If you look closely, there are things you need to get rid of. Go lean. Many of us carry too much baggage. Sometimes debt comes from drying up or inadequate income stream. I'm going to speak a bit about income this morning as well, or this afternoon now. Sometimes life happens, and so we're not here to castigate anybody. As a matter of fact, the vast majority of people who end up in debt because of life situation. Sometimes sicknesses, sometimes illnesses, sometimes wilderness experience, sometimes investment choices, mistakes. I've made the same mistake. Mine wasn't a scam, unless I'm the one that's scamming myself. But I went into investments that failed. I was so wealthy that I thought I could deal with it. And then it compounded and compounded and compounded until it got me into trouble. So no one, and that's why tomorrow this place will be full now. But come here on Saturday to hear about this. I don't need that. I'm okay. All right. I'm waiting for you. I'm your pastor. We will bind and lose together when the time comes. Investment losses and business failures. Any business can fail. Any business can fail. Death. Death can change circumstances, just like happened with the prophet. And life circumstances. So it matters less that we find ourselves in debt. What matters more is an appreciation of where am I? The assessment of what am I doing? What am I going to do about it? She sat back and said, okay, what do I have? The guy has come here and gone, okay, fine, I've learned my lessons. It's not going to happen a second time. But I'm a chartered accountant. I have a job. We have income. Someone else would have gone deep into despair that they would even lose their job because they would start to underperform. But she didn't. She rolled up her sleeves and got on with it. Because the only person that's looking out for you is who? I love you. I'm your pastor, for those who come to this church. But I have enough of my own to carry. So I will pray with you, but I still will carry my own body. You must carry yours. And you better start carrying it. So the first thing you have to ask yourself is, where am I? I had some debt profiles. Can we put up debt profiles? Are you asset rich? Some people are asset rich and cash poor and have decent income. Then you need to restructure your asset portfolio. At a point in my life, had £1 million in income in this country. And so I had assets. And so when some of the businesses I invested in failed and challenges came and all of that, I got rid of some of the assets. It didn't change my personality. I'm the one that bought them. So don't sit on assets and be choked on cash flow difficulties. It was good to see year 10, year 20, year 30, 36, 38, if you don't have tenants in the properties. And the mortgage on your 30 properties is choking you such that you're getting red letter after red letter. You better reduce them to 18 and be at peace. Is it not true? And start building from there. Some are asset poor, cash poor, but income is decent. Then you need to get into savings. You need to cut back on your consumption. Some are asset poor, cash poor, income poor. Then you need to do a reflection. Am I in the wrong profession? What do I need to do differently? Is it time to carry my suitcase and join the Abuja crowd for those who are Nigerian extraction? But speaking more seriously, what can I do to enhance my income? I don't have a lot of time left, but I'm going to go very quickly through some of the things you can do. There are things you can do to increase your capacity to earn. You are skilled for something, but start with knowing where you are. And don't be secretive about it. Some people are secretive and unrealistic. What will they say? Is it what would they say, or how are you sorting this situation out? You better cry and seek help. You better go and see Festus very quietly and privately and say, please, can I have your phone number? I say, please, just guide me here. And whatever you hear, test it. You better come to your pastor. I said, Pastor, I didn't want to speak openly. He's not adding up. Thank God you have a pastor who understands scripture and who understands money. So we won't just speak the language of faith alone. We'll talk the principles and the reality. And if you must cut back, cut back. You can always come back. Praise God. You can always come back. Moving along very quickly. To get out of debt requires a decision. You have to make a decision to get out of debt. You have to determine and purpose to do some things differently. I'm just going to skip through a lot of stuff and focus on the critical things. Do you have the next slide? Debt reduction elimination plan? Can we put that up? I need to try and finish within 5-10 minutes. Do we have that slide? Debt reduction elimination plan. Pay a little more into your debt account. It's a table. Okay. If you registered, we'll make sure you get these tables sent to you so that at least you can reflect on them. I don't know why technology is causing issues. It should be there as a PowerPoint slide. Strategies to reduce debt. Don't incur any more debt. Put a cap on it where you are. They've already dealt with things like go and negotiate. There's nothing a lender hates more than a borrower who does not engage. If you engage with them, there's always opportunity. You can get holidays, you can get deferrals, they can even move you to a lower interest rate. I used to be a credit manager. We like nothing more than for a debtor to speak to us because we don't want to go through the legal cost of dealing with foreclosures and pursuing debt. That's not the purpose of a lender. A lender wants to get their money back. And they're sitting on a lot of interest income. Let me let you into a little secret. We're willing to give up 50% of our interest income to get our principal back. Do you understand that? Because it's a lot of money, free money, the interest income. So if you come and engage, we will speak to you, or they will speak to you. I'm no longer a banker. Asset strip to raise cash. Yeah. Try and rebuild your credit profile. Aggregate your debt. Okay, put it all in one place. I've given you a clue. You can use 0% interest, but then make it a plan to start paying off one at a time, so that you break down this huge mountain that is sitting in front of you. Increase family income. Find things that you can sell or do to raise income. Yeah, I had a slide on, I don't have a time, ways to earn income. Either an employee, your income is based on your position. They're paying you for your time. You better know that at some point in time, your time will no longer be valuable and they will stop paying you for it. So employee status should be a short-term thing. It's a stepping stone into something else. You should ultimately be aiming to be a property owner, a business owner, own something. Let something be working for you. Let tenants be paying your way. So use the income. Don't spend all that you earn and be waiting for every month to get new money coming in. I had a slide on managing your income. Let's put that up very quickly. Managing your income. That's just to reinforce what Festus shared with us. Tithe 10%, housing 35%, food 15%, automobile 10%. Do we have that slide? What's happening, guys? Do you have my PowerPoint or no? Okay, it's just broken. But managing your income. So that's about slide 20. Automobile debt 5%, insurance 5%, recreation and entertainment 5%, clothing 5%, and savings 10%. Savings 10% is the pay yourself that he was speaking to us about. And so it's not rigid, but this should give you broad context for what you must do. There you go. What you must do with your money. That's just to affirm what you have heard already. And the truth be, only Christians question given. The charity sector all over the world is billions of dollars strong. Now, of course, you have to also choose the right charities. Yeah, because the charities that spend half the money on administrative. But that's another matter for another day. The more important thing is people understand the concept of you want God on your side fighting for you. I love the analogy of the neighbor that's not working. I love that. So all it is saying is that there's somebody watching over you when you give away part of your sweat. And do something counterintuitive. You've tried your own way for so long. Why don't you try God's way? If the debt is so large, you say, I'm in debt. They're saying I should be giving the 10%. That means you need a miracle. If the debt is so large that your income cannot pay it, don't you think you need a supernatural help? And wouldn't that come from someone who has the ability beyond you to now take the little you have? The Bible says little becomes much in the hands of God. But I'm a pastor, so I'm biased, so it's okay. Take what you will of that. I had a number of slides on managing your income. Don't follow the fad. Buy X demo. I must share this. You know when you drive out of a car lot, that gleaming brand new car that you drove out of a car lot, you sign the paper, that 50,000, I don't know what car you guys drive these days. Okay, let me use Tesla, 75,000 Tesla. You signed all the papers, you gave them your credit card, you drove out, and then you got to the roundabout, and you remembered today's teaching. And you're like, "Ewo, I've overreached. I can't afford this." And you turned around the roundabout and headed back in. You'll get 20% less than what you paid. Do you know why? It's called VAT. They won't give you back the VAT. The more it just depreciates straight away. He hasn't even put any money. So think before you buy. If you have two cars in your household and you really don't use them, the Jaguar example, you're using the train all the time. If I even now in London, you less won't even allow us breathe. Cars are driving us rather than us driving them now. You better offload them and use one family car for Sunday service. And the rest of the time, take the train. And then defray every debt, buy a property. And every time you're driving past the property, that's my Jaguar. That's not to say don't drive a good car. I drive a very good car and I love it. But I don't change my car every 18 months or 2 years. I don't follow fad. My wife has to convince me to shop. I don't buy. You guys be amazed because of how you see me. I don't shop. I don't shop. Why? Because, and please hear me and hear me well. I'm not saying shopping is a bad thing. I'm just saying don't make it your priority. But you can still look good. You can dress well. The one you have, dress for less. You know, the one you have, keep it well. When you buy it, let it work. In fact, the shoppers, the producers don't like me because when I buy it, I wait till it's out of production. I'll close. Our time is done. Have you been blessed? Yes. Praise God. I close with the final slide, which again affirms what we've heard. I fully support, endorse, and encourage insurance. Festus Arisha is here. Speak with him. Pastor Massa is here. Speak with them. Don't just, and again, too much of anything is bad. Even too much of water is bad. You can buy every kind of insurance that exists. Critical illness, health illness, pastoral protection, church protection. If you want to spend all your money on insurance, you will spend everything and there will be nothing left. There will be nothing to show for it. But don't go from zero to 100%. There's a happy middle somewhere. A pastor, I'm going to close now, a pastor colleague passed on in the last week or so, and we're online. We're having to deal with what is left on the table. We live in a time, and I mean there's not a lot left on the table. We're living a time and season when God expects us to be wise. You may not be in debt, but look at your financial structures. take care of your, Bible says that a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children. And the Bible says that he who does not care for his household is worse than an infidel. So there is a responsibility on every one of us, in spite of where we are at this point, to try and do right by those that were blessed to lead, to father, to mother, to engage with, to make our lives an example. May God help us all in Jesus' name.
Thank you, PYO. Thank you so much. It's always, always a blessing listening to PYO. If you worship here, if you fellowship here, you will attest to that. So thank you, sir. Thank you for sharing your experience, your knowledge. We appreciate you today. We appreciate you always. To the ladies and gentlemen, we're at the section of today's program where it says Q&A.